శ్రీగురుభ్యో నమః. హరిః ఓం రామాయ రామభద్రాయ రామచంద్రాయ వేధసే రఘునాథాయ నాథాయ సీతాయ పతయే నమః. కూజంతం రామ రామేతి మధురం మధురాక్షరం ఆరుహ్య కవితా శాఖాం వందే వాల్మీకి కోకిలం. వ్యోమనాథస్తమోభేదీ రుగ్యజుస్సామపారగః. We have done up to that. The next line will be ఘనవృష్టిరపాం మిత్రః వింధ్యవీథీప్లవంగమః. So before we start discussing ఘనవృష్టి etc., one or two questions are pending from that part of the Aditya Hridayam. We'll sit in. So హిరణ్యగర్భశిశిరః, that was the earlier verse. In that, the word Shishiraha, does it have two meanings? That is the question. Could be. Could be. So, Shishiraha, Tapanaha, there are two words side by side. Shishiraha means cool. Tapanaha means hot. Sun is both, you know. Sun is very cool. Cool in the sense makes you very comfortable in the winter time. When you move into the sunlight, you feel very good. In that way, in the winter time, one who makes us comfortable, Shishiraha. And in the summer time, one who makes us very uncomfortable, Tapanaha. So that is how the meanings were taken. It is also possible the word Shishiraha has another meaning which I do not remember. So let us leave it at that. If you go to some commentators, they may come out with a different meaning. Also, tapano bhaskaro ravihi is one reading, tapano haskaro ravihi is another reading. I have taken tapano haskaro ravihi. What could be the reason for that? Because I have followed Tilaka commentary, which is standard commentary on Ramayana, Sanskrit commentary. And Tilaka lived at least 500 to 1000 years back, and whatever manuscript he got, it is definitely much earlier and more authentic than the variety of manuscripts that we have today. And therefore, I relied upon that manuscript in which you find the expression tapanaha ahaskaraha. And I explained the same way. In any case, it doesn't make big difference. Bhaskaraha came already earlier. And so one more time it can come also. Rahaskaraha is also a good way of saying it. That is settled. Then I said, Rugyajussamaparagaha. That is what I was saying. So at that time I said, there are three Vedas. Rugyajussamabhihi yajanti. So the question is about Atharvana Veda and its Upanishads. You see, when I said three Vedas, I mentioned there is the Atharvana Veda also. But I was having the Vedic religion in mind. Means Vedic ritualism. Lots of rituals are there prescribed by the Veda. Today nobody is doing them, mostly. Very rarely you come across somebody who performs Vedic rituals. Okay? Otherwise mostly people are performing only Smriti, means latter day religious texts. And Puranas, the mythological texts. So many rituals arise out of those texts. And they do those rituals. Vedic rituals are not performed by many. Very rarely you come across someone performing a Vedic ritual. Okay? You may not even know whether it is being done. In some places in South India, and even more rarely in North India, you come across these Vedic rituals. Very rarely. Most of the society performs Smriti-related and Purana-related rituals only. In this country, the Indian diaspora, they don't even know what are the Vedic rituals. Everybody knows only the Puranic rituals. So that is how it is. And therefore now what we have is Vedic religion, a religion which is based on Vedas. There it is entirely based on Rig, Yajus and Samaveda. And there is no contribution coming from Atharvana Veda. Okay? Rig, Yajus, Samabhir, Yajanti. So Vedantic religion and Vedantic Upasana is based, or it originates from these three Vedas only. And if you keep a historic perspective, Rigveda is the most ancient and Atharvana Veda is the latest, much later Veda. And in the religion of the Rigveda people, Yajurveda and Samaveda are included, but not Atharvana Veda. Atharvana Veda came much later. Therefore, what I said about Vedas, three Vedas, that applies to Vedic religion. Upanishads as such are considered later day development, because in life also, initially you perform karmas and then you move into upasanas and finally you end up with Jnana Marga, the Upanishadic wisdom. Even in a person's life, that is the movement, okay, generally. Similarly, you can apply that to the historic development of the wisdom also. So, the three Vedas were originally connected with the Vedic religion and then gradually Upanishadic wisdom also came into existence. That way you can look at it. Atharvana Veda has no contribution towards the religion, towards the Vedic religion, mostly. Okay, there may be exceptions here and there, because the religion is so complex. Whatever statement you make, you find an exception there. General statement I am making. But by the time Atharvana Veda took shape, Upanishadic wisdom has become quite prominent. And therefore, you find a good number of Upanishads in Atharvana Veda also. In fact, if you take 10 Upanishads, the majority contribution is coming from Atharvana Veda. How? You look at the Upanishads, Mundaka, Mandukya are from Atharvana Veda. Aitareya is from Rig Veda. Okay? Prashna is also from Atharvana Veda. So, three from Atharvana Veda. And one from Rig Veda, the first Veda. And then the remaining 10 Upanishads, you know, 4 I have covered. The remaining 6 come from the other 2 Vedas. Therefore, there is an important contribution coming from Atharvana Veda. And the 2 Upanishads, Mundaka and Mandukya, are in Atharvana Veda. Okay? So, Atharvana Veda is not a primary Veda. But Atharvana Veda Upanishads are some of the important or even primary Upanishads, okay? What applies to Vedic religion is something different, where Rig Veda dominates. But by the time you come to Upanishadic wisdom, Atharvana Veda has a greater contribution. That is how things stand, okay? Then final question is, and the reason for the things to be that way also I have explained in a way. Okay. Final question is, should we read Phalashruti? Not necessary. If you know it, one time you read, you understand what is the Phalashruti, that is enough. You need not read it. To know Phalashruti is essential. What is the Phalashruti saying, you should know? Having recited the whole thing, Phalashruti will be one or two statements. You should know them. That is enough. You need not recite every single time. People recite that also. Sometimes the Phalashrutis are so lengthy, they'll be reciting the Phalashruti. Lalita Sahasranama Phalashruti is very lengthy. Purva Pithika, Uttara Pithika. So the introduction and the Phalashruti, quite lengthy. If you drop the Purva Pithika and Uttara Pithika, then it becomes more amenable for recitation. You may do that. You need not recite every single time. But at least one time you go through it and know what it says. In some of the things, the Phalashruti is very simple. Therefore, even if you say it, no harm. Like Pratasmarana Stotram, three verses and one Phalashruti. Three bigger verses and one small verse of Phalashruti. Generally, we don't say the Phalashruti. We know it, we don't say it. Even if it is just sitting there, in 5 minutes it can be explained. In 30 seconds it can be chanted. Even if it is said, no harm. So that explains those questions. That leaves one more question, which will be for tomorrow morning. Then we come to Ghanavrushtihi Apamitraha. This is the Upasana. All the time it is Upasana. Means you have to make the mind sit close to God. Okay? When you say Upasana, what is this Upasana? To visualize divinity or Brahman everywhere. That is the Upasana. Brahman, the immortal, is everywhere. What you see with the eyes and ears, what you see with the eyes and hear with the ears, and what you perceive with the mind are only names and forms. So you have to make a particular effort to rise above the names and forms. By understanding that the names and forms are unreal, the underlying reality alone is the truth. And the underlying reality of this myriad names and forms is the Brahman. So you should connect to that Brahman. It is like every time you see ornaments, you connect to gold. That kind of connection you should make. Every time a food is served in the plate, you have to connect to calories. You have to do that. That keeps you healthy. If you don't connect to calories, rasamalai. Rasamalai is not good for health because it is loaded with calories, that is one thing. And for cholesterol, triglycerides, etc., rasamalai is not a good thing. In rasamalai, what will happen is the milk is taken and boiled and boiled and boiled and boiled till it becomes resin. The moment you hear the word halwa, see whether it has already resinified. Some resin is being served in the plate, you pay attention to that. If it is resin, don't go for it. Why should you eat resin? And so very highly polymerized stuff it is. And then the thermal reactions happen. And they are full of free radicals. When the food is heated too much, oil, etc., even milk, you boil it and you boil one time, that is fine. The milk boils, say, around at 110 degrees centigrade. You boil it and then put it down, that is fine. Up to that, it is safe. But you go on boiling it till it becomes very thick. Then the temperature, if you put a thermometer, they don't put thermometer. If you put a thermometer, you will know how much temperature is going. It will go to 300, 350 also. By the time it becomes a gel. It becomes like a colloid or a gel, a polymeric material. And in the process, all these long chain fatty acids break down, giving rise to free radicals. And free radicals are very dangerous for health. That's why they take antioxidants. These antioxidants, they trap the free radicals and save you from the damage that the free radicals can do to the tissues. Therefore, you should not go towards such foods. So, therefore, whenever food is served to you, your focus should be not on the dishes, what kind of dishes it is, the name and form, what kind of taste it will have. That is the Namarupa thing it is. What you hear, what you see, and what you taste, all of that is Namarupa. What is it? Essentially, as food, what is it? How many calories it is? That is the underlying reality. So you should focus on the calories. That keeps you healthy. Because when you focus on the calories, you will have a control on the calories, how many calories you are consuming per day. that determines the good health of the person. So everywhere, the Nama Rupa you should overcome. You should cross, go beyond Nama Rupa. Like even people, you should not look at them in terms of caste, creed, race, religion. You should look at them as human beings. That is going beyond Nama Rupa. So many, in fact, most of the people don't do that. In fact, you do not come across human beings. You come across all kinds of self-definitions. You do not come across human beings. In a Vedanta class also, you don't see human beings. And who is adhikari of the Vedanta? Human being. Not for karma. For karma, adhikari is defined separately. Whereas for Vedanta, the wisdom of the Upanishads, the human being is the adhikari. Adhikari means the eligible person. Therefore, unless you see people as human being is the most beautiful word. Because it is the being. You are the being, sat. Human sat. You see, sadekameva somyedamagra asit. The sat, the being, which is Brahman, conditioned as the human. Very beautiful, you know. So human being, animal being, living being, these are all beings, sat. Therefore, human being is the most beautiful expression. And you should focus on the human being, rising above all these different names and forms. So that is called upasana. Upasana is, you are conscious of the names and forms, but at the same time, you rise above the dualism, etc., created by the names and forms. You rise above the attachments and aversions created by the names and forms, and you arrive at the reality, underlying reality, that is called upasana. Therefore, you see Brahman in the east, you see Brahman in the west. What is east? East and west are, they are arbitrary. If you know the exact model of the universe, there is no east, there is no west. They are very arbitrary. So east is, what is ahead of you is east. What is behind you is west. So otherwise you drop east-west, say, ahead of you is Brahman, Brahma Purastat. Behind you is Brahman. Towards the left it is Brahman. Towards the right it is Brahman. Above Brahman, below Brahman. That kind of a vision is the upasana. So when you get this vision of upasana into your consciousness, then what happens is you will abandon all kinds of wrong thinking, crooked stratagems, etc. You will abandon. And then frustration, etc. You will abandon. The sense of friend versus foe, that kind of a sense, you will abandon all that. Manipulation, frustration, complaining nature, all these things will be abandoned. So then you remain focused on the reality, which is everywhere and in everything. That is the upasana. This you apply to the water cycle. Ghanavrushti rapam mitraha. This vision of upasana, if you apply to water cycle, the water cycle is put in place by the sun. Water stagnant is no good. Water must be flowing. Stagnant water, water doesn't flow, becomes murky and it will smell bad also soon. It becomes the source of many impurities and also many infections and all that. Water should always flow. Water should not be stagnant. That is called water cycle. So this water cycle is a very big thing it is. So the sun evaporates water. Evaporating water means if you evaporate 100 ml of water in the kitchen, you will know how difficult it is. You put 100 ml water in a vessel and put on the fire and see how much time it will take. Do you know, water doesn't evaporate easily. Because in water, every molecule is connected to every other molecule through what is called hydrogen bond. And that's why water is high boiling point, 100 degrees. If you look at the periodic table, oxygen, just below oxygen, there is sulfur. బ్యాలెన్స్ ఈ సిక్స్త్ గ్రూప్. ఆక్సిజన్ అండ్ సల్ఫర్, దే బిలాంగ్ టు ది సేమ్ గ్రూప్ విత్ సేమ్ బ్యాలెన్సీ. పుట్ టూ హైడ్రోజన్స్, H2O అండ్ H2S. H2S ఈజ్ ఎ గ్యాస్, H2O ఈజ్ లిక్విడ్. అండ్ H2O బాయిలింగ్ పాయింట్ ఈజ్ వెరీ హై, 100 degrees ఈజ్ ఇట్స్ బాయిలింగ్ పాయింట్ అట్ 1 atmospheric ప్రెషర్. Why a corresponding gas of the sulfur is a gas? The corresponding molecule of the oxygen is a water, liquid. Why? Because in H2S there are no hydrogen bonds, whereas in H2O there are hydrogen bonds. Hydrogen bonds is like attachment that we have discussed in the morning. When a molecule wants to leave the bulk of the water and tries to go into the water, into the gaseous state, all the molecules of the liquid water, they hold it back. They won't allow it to get out. That's why you have to provide a lot of heat. And it will be boiling and boiling for half an hour. You have to evaporate 100 ml water, you require half an hour time. So much energy you have to put into it. Now you imagine, sun evaporates millions, and why millions, billions, billions of tons of water. And then all this water is taken up beyond a mile or 2 miles. You put water on the ceiling. In the ceiling they put a water tank and pump water to the ceiling water tank. How much energy you expend to put the water from ground level to 2 stories above? So much electricity you have to spend. Whereas the sun takes all these billions of tons of water 2 miles above. And he gives all that energy to that water. And then other conditions are provided, and so clouds will form. Then you have to understand, seawater doesn't boil at 100 degrees. It boils at a higher temperature because they are loaded with salts. And the salt water doesn't boil. So that's why there is a proverb in Telugu, salt water is useless for making a dal. Something like that. Something like that. I am not sure what it is. Pappulu udakavu. So that is the proverb. Some such proverb is there. Therefore, sun is evaporating not simple water. He is evaporating salt water. So there is a demand on Dubai that they should change their water system because they are making water from the ocean. And in the process, they are expending enormous amounts of electricity and all that. And they are polluting the Gulf also, Persian Gulf, because in the process of purifying water, so much salty water is pushed back into the Gulf. They are having all kinds of problems. Whereas sun will do all these things very effectively. So how he is doing, you never know. How much energy sun is putting onto the earth, how much of that energy is required to evaporate all the water of the oceans and take it to the pure water above. When it rains, you collect that water, you can directly drink it. You need not purify it, you need not filter it. In fact, it will have a little nitric acid, which is very good for health also. Very micro quantities of nitric acid, which is formed in the atmosphere by the lightning. There is nitrogen, and nitric oxide is formed. It dissolves in the water. And so nitrous oxide gives nitrous acid. Nitric oxide gives nitric acid. A little micro quantities of ppm quantities of these acids are also there. That water, that is the right kind of water to drink. You catch it without it, before it touches anything of the earth, any roof or the floor. Directly you catch it, you can drink that water right away. That is what birds do. It is said by the poets that some of these birds, they look up when it is ready to rain, they open their mouth and keep it there. And all the water they get into their mouths. Therefore, so much water. That water, it rains on the mountains, everywhere it rains. And then it is called Parjanya Nyayam. Means the rain doesn't discriminate. It rains in the desert, it rains in the field where crops are growing. It rains on the houses and people stand in the rain. It rains on their heads. It doesn't discriminate. It rains everywhere. And on the roads, why to rain on the roads? Water is a waste, but it rains. So no discrimination. Rain comes. And when it falls on the mountains, the rivers are created. And sometimes in cold places, there instead of rain, you get a snow. And all the snow falls, creating huge ice fields in the north. Ice fields are created because of the snow falling. And these ice fields generate glaciers. And from glaciers come again rivers. If you study this, it's a big science it is. Under this cycle, it will be going on. So oceans evaporated, rain and then rivers and glaciers and rivers and all that, and again go and merge in the ocean. That water cycle. This water cycle is made possible by the sun. Therefore, sun is described as Ghanavrushtihi. Sun is God. Sun is Hiranyagarbha. Okay? So Ghanavrushtihi, one who produces enormous amounts of rains, Ghanavrushtihi, Kundapota Varshamo, means it rains cats and dogs, or dogs and cats. That is the idea of Ghanavrushtihi. And Apam Mitraha, the sun is very much friendly towards waters. Apam Mitraha. Valmiki's usage is Mitraha Pumlinga. In regular Sanskrit, in Panini's Sanskrit, Mitraha is, it should be Napumsakalinga, Mitram. But here, Apam Mitram, but then when it is sun, sun is called Mitraha. And Mitra Shabda, if you find it in Pumlinga, it is the sun. And if you find it in Napumsakalinga, it is friend. So now, instead of saying Apam Mitram, it is said Apam Mitraha. So he is the friend of the waters. And also he is very friendly to waters. And also he is the Mitra. So sun is called Mitraha. You know that? Sun is called Mitraha. Mitraha is the name of the sun. The moment you say the word Mitraha, you should not say friend. It means the sun. Mitram is the friend. Okay? Why sun is called Mitraha? Because he is friend to all life on earth. And all prayers of the sun in the Vedic literature, they present sun as the Mitra. Mitrasya charishani dhritashirabho devasya sanasim. You must have heard that mantra. The Sanjhavandanam people know that mantra. So, therefore sun is Mitraha. And Mitrasya chakshusha sarvani bhutani samikshantam. That is from Rigveda. The Rigveda advises people, you adopt the sight, the way sun looks at all life forms, a similar sight you adopt. The sun looks at all life forms equally, samadrushtihi. All life forms are looked at by the sun equally. If it is winter season, whosoever goes into the sunlight gets the warmth. And if it is summer, whosoever steps into the sun gets scorched. No distinction, no discrimination. So be like that. There is no friend, there is no foe. There is only divinity. That is the vision of the sun. You adopt the vision of the sun towards all life forms. Mitrasya chakshusha sarvani bhutani samikshantam. O people, you develop this sight of the sun, you understand how the sun looks at all life forms, you also look at all life forms in the similar way. That is the vision of the Rigveda. Therefore, the word Mitraha is very appropriately used there. Ghanavrushti rapam Mitraha. So that is all about water cycle. Then, Vindhya Vithi Plavangamaha. So the one who moves fast, Plavangamaha, so who moves fast, ఇన్ ద ఇంటర్స్టెలార్ స్పేస్ వింధ్య వీథి. సో వింధ్య మీన్స్ ది స్టార్స్ అండ్ ది ప్లానెట్స్, వీథి ది స్పేస్ ఇన్ విచ్ ది స్టార్స్ అండ్ ప్లానెట్స్ ఆర్ దేర్. వీథి స్ట్రిక్ట్లీ ఇట్స్ మీనింగ్ ఈజ్ స్ట్రీట్. సో ఇన్ ఇండియా వాట్ దే డూ, దే కాల్ ఇట్ వీధి. ఇన్స్టెడ్ ఆఫ్ సేయింగ్ వీథి దే సే వీధి. సో ఎవ్రీథింగ్ థా ఈజ్ కన్వర్టెడ్ టు ధా. దిస్ ఈజ్ ఏ మిస్టేక్ దే డూ. లైక్ గ్రంథాలయము, ఇది లైబ్రరీ, గ్రంథాలయము. బట్ ఎవరివేర్ దే రైట్ గ్రంథాలయము ధా. యు అండర్స్టాండ్ దట్ ఇట్ ఈజ్ రాంగ్. సో ఐ రిమెంబర్ వన్స్ ఐ ఆస్క్డ్ సంస్క్రిట్ టీచర్, ఐ వాజ్ ఎ కిడ్ స్టడీయింగ్ సంస్క్రిట్, ఐ సెడ్ వాట్ ఈజ్ ది మీనింగ్ ఆఫ్ అర్థ, దట్ ఈజ్ వాట్ ఐ హ్యావ్ టు ఆస్క్. సో ఇన్స్టెడ్ ఆఫ్ ఆస్కింగ్ వాట్ ఈజ్ ది మీనింగ్ ఆఫ్ అర్థ, ఐ ఆస్క్డ్ వాట్ ఈజ్ ది మీనింగ్ ఆఫ్ అర్థ, దట్ ఈజ్ హౌ ఐ ఆస్క్. సో ఇన్స్టెడ్ ఆఫ్ సేయింగ్ థాత్ ఐ హ్యావ్ టు సే. ఇన్స్టెడ్ ఆఫ్ సేయింగ్ తాత్ ద సెకండ్ మహాప్రాణవర్ణ, ఐ సెడ్ ద ఫోర్త్ మహాప్రాణవర్ణ ధా. దెన్ ద టీచర్ వాజ్ వెరీ అన్హ్యాపీ అండ్ హీ లుక్డ్ ఎట్ మీ విత్ వెరీ సివియర్ లుక్. హీ లుక్డ్ ఎట్ మీ విత్ సమ్ సివియరిటీ అండ్ టోల్డ్ మీ, ఐ కెన్ టెల్ యూ ది మీనింగ్ ఆఫ్ అర్థ. యూ వాంట్ ది మీనింగ్ ఆఫ్ అర్థ ఆర్ అర్ధ? అర్ధ ఈజ్ హ్యాఫ్. Is that what you are looking for? I said no. Then why do you say ardha? Arthaha. That is the meaning you want. Yes. Then you pronounce properly. You say it properly. What meaning you want? I corrected myself and I said arthaha. Then he said wealth. But if you don't pronounce it properly and say ardhaha, then it is not wealth. It is half. So people don't understand all these things. They pronounce whatever they pronounce. So vithi, they stopped pronouncing it as tha. In the entire Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, they are starting pronouncing it as vidhi. So they say Dangetivar vidhi, Phalana vidhi, Phalana vidhi, vidhi the street. So here is the same meaning, vithi, not vidhi. So the vithi, the street of planets and stars, that is the vithi. Okay, here you have street, you know, phalana street. So they say street or avenue, street they use, right? That is the meaning of vithi. So the street in which you find planets and stars, that is the street in which the sun travels very fast. Vindhya vithi plavangamaha, moving very fast. So you see, what is suggested is you learn to contemplate upon the space. It is the space. You see, where is your focus? On the material things or on the space? If you focus on the material things, you are a worldly person. If you focus on space, you are a spiritual person. Okay? That is the contrast. And also in this creation, do you have any idea about the volume of the space occupied by the matter? It is less than 0.1%. Okay? So, when you take the space and the matter in between, like Earth is there, a big globe of matter. And then between Earth and Moon, the distance it takes 20 days or 40 days to traverse. Long time it takes, huge distance it is. And between Earth and Moon, almost there is nothing else. There are some asteroids, some big, big stones going round and round. They do not constitute much matter. So the space is so vast, and there is matter, very sparse matter. It is here, it is there, like that. Even an atom you take, the atom has all of its weight in the nucleus. because the weight of electrons is insignificant. The nucleus is where the entire matter is present. And if you take the volume of the atom, atomic volume, and then the nucleus volume, if you compare, you will understand that it is like a football in a football field. Therefore, entire mass of the atom is concentrated in that nucleus, which is like a football in the football field, and the rest of it is all space. That is the atom. And if you go to the planetary level, the atomic level and the planetary level are very similar. The atomic orbitals, etc., were understood based on the planetary situation. Like planets are going round the sun, similarly electrons are going round the nucleus. That is how it came. They are very close to each other. Therefore, the point is, the universe is 0.1% matter, 99.9% space. That is what the universe. Now, where is your focus? On 0.1% or 99.9%? So, you should move on to 99.9%. That is the focus. This is the space meditation. That is the upasana. And it is said that Bhagavan Buddha meditated upon space. That is his first meditation. Buddha means meditation. You do not see Buddha standing and looking. That is that kind of a statue of Buddha you don't find anywhere. Buddha you find only in one pose, and that is sitting and meditating. That is the only Buddha people know. So Buddha embodies meditation. And he meditated upon space, not on a form and not on a sound also. Only on space. First to begin with space. Then meditate upon that inner awareness. So Bhutakasha, outer space. Then Chittakasha, mental space. And Chidakasha, the space of awareness. That is the sequence of meditation. Therefore, you learn to meditate upon the space. And that name, Vindhya Vithi Plavangamaha, is an expression of meditation. That is the space in which the sun traverses. Assuming that sun traverses from the east to west, that is how it appears, you know. Take the appearance as valid for the time being, the sun traverses from east to west in that space of planets and stars. Vindhya Vithi Plavangamaha. Then, if you understand a little physics and all that, sun doesn't move, only it is the earth moves around the sun. All planets move around the sun. That is true, but these move in orbits around the sun. The sun moves in a straight line in a Milky Way galaxy, and that is the space in which the sun moves. So that is the space. It is all about space. Elliptical orbit. It moves in elliptical orbit. So, but the curvature is so zero, almost close to zero, that it looks like a straight line. It's okay. Therefore, sun is also moving in a way, but moving in a very unique space of the Milky Way galaxy. And what you see from east to west, the sun is moving. He is moving in the space of planet, not in the space of the aeroplanes and all that, not in the atmospheric space, in the deep space of planets and stars. Vindhya Vithi Plavangamaha. That is how that verse is now completed. So, Akasha Vithi. So people say it Vithi, that is a printing mistake. Akasha Vithi, that in Telugu, that dot must be there in this letter. You see, the idea of this expression and similar expressions, the idea is to become familiar with the vastness. You have to become familiar with the vastness. Because vastness is the Brahman. Brahman, the word means the vastness. and the vastness of what? The physical space to begin with, and then the vastness of that inner light of awareness. You see, that vastness you have to become familiar with. Like you look at your body, it is a small dot in the whole space. It is not even a dot. It is insignificant body. But you look at the eyesight, eyesight is not insignificant, because eyesight can cover a long distance and everything between the eyes and the range of the eyesight. So you can see up to the horizon. Probably it is something like 25 miles you can see. So if you take an arc like this, so say some 60 degrees, 60 degrees, therefore remove 120 degrees from 360, so within a range of 240 degrees up to 25 miles, that is the range of eyesight. And eyesight is you. You are the eyesight. You are the body, then you are not even a dot. But if you are the eyesight, you pervade. Now you are vast. As eyesight, you are vast. How much vast? In an arc of 240 degrees, 25 miles. That much you can see with your eyes. That is your vastness. Then move from eyesight to the mind, your vastness increases. You see, there was a physicist called Pascal. His physics is all hydrostatics. That is his physics. Great physicist. His laws are responsible for all these machinery that is using the hydrostatics. So he said, when you are the body, you are not even a dot in space, but you uplift yourself from the body to the mind. Only that much you do. When you are one with the mind, you can understand the entire universe. That is your vastness. And then take one more step from mind to Atma. One more step. You see, Archimedes, he said, if you can give me the right lever, I can move the earth from one place to the other. That is what he said. Similarly, if you move from the body to the mind, as body, you are not even a dot in this vast space, in this universe. But as mind, you can study, of course, with the help of telescopes and all that, and with the help of microscopes, you can study the entire universe. From the smallest particle to the biggest galaxy, all of that you can study. That is your vastness. Means you become your vastness, your pervasiveness. It is multiplied by almost a factor of infinity from body to mind. You got that? Now you go from mind to Atma, the inner light of awareness. Then you are the one who creates, sustains and annihilates this entire universe as awareness absolute, so you become one with Chetanam Brahma Tattvamasi. These are the quantum leaps from body to mind, mind to Atma. So here Vindhyavithi Plavangamaha advises us to take that first leap, give up the body identification, and give up this attachment to names and forms. The names and forms will be going on. Things happen. You don't make anything happen. Things happen. So rise above these names and forms. Rise above the body identification. And go to the level of the mind at least. There your vastness is now multiplied by a factor of infinite. You can study the entire universe. You can understand the whole space. And what all that space contains within itself, all that you can understand. That is the kind of, that is the power of upasana. Upasana is a very big thing it is. You become what you think. That is the power of upasana. Yad bhavam tad bhavati. That is the power of upasana. That's why people should be very careful. So in selecting what you want to do upasana of, suppose you do the upasana of a jada, insentient thing, like you do the upasana of Mercedes Benz, suppose. That is the jada, insentient. You become jada yourself. You are as good as a tamoguna, you are as good as a metal object in doing the upasana of the jada. If you do the upasana of an animal, you are like animal, you become animal-like. You do the upasana of the big, you become big. So, that's why upasana, one should be very careful. If you do the upasana of the wealth, then the stock market dips, then you also dip along with it. That is the upasana of the wealth. And if you do the upasana of the food, then you become sick very soon. You should not do the upasana of the food. That is what people do. They are upasakas of the food. Always talking about food, thinking about food. Always. So, suppose what is the breakfast today? Dosha. Then a discussion ensues on dosha. And what kind, how many kinds of doshas are there? How big the dosha can be? How tasty it is, that dosha I have tasted, this dosha I have not tasted. Like that the upasana goes on. And that is how I have seen it. And these dosha upasakas, they become sugar patients. It is better because dosha is all carbohydrate. Very little pulses will be there, very little protein. Most of it is carbohydrate. Therefore, you eat a dosha and get out. Don't do the upasana of food. You should not do the upasana of food. Then the question is asked, why to do any upasana? Upasana is inherent in the human beings. They do the upasana of something or the other. If they don't do the upasana of the sun god, they will do upasana of something else. Some silly thing they do the upasana. And when they do the upasana of the Namarupa, like many people do the upasana of the gold. Therefore, they worship the goddess of gold or god of gold. They worship with the flowers made of gold. Their upasana of gold reaches a level whereby they become jada like gold. Gold is jada. Jada means insentient. Therefore, it is advised that be careful in choosing what you are doing the upasana of. Some people do the upasana of the wardrobe. That is the upasana they do. So, then you become like wardrobe. And some people do the upasana of the sofa. They become the sofa. Means as dull and insentient as the sofa. So, a carpet, some people do the upasana of the carpet, they become like a carpet. Really. Therefore, you should not, that's why you cannot be without upasana. There is upasana in people's lives, and therefore you put the right thing in the place of that upasana. What is it that you are contemplating upon? Upasana of what? You do the upasana of the Brahman, you do the upasana of the space, you become like Buddha, enlightened. Vindhya Vithi Plavanga Maha. That finishes. So, then also when you see the God who is moving in that interstellar space, the same God is moving in the heart also. That gives you the vision of Aham Brahmasmi. That is how the upasana helps the people to elevate themselves. That's why here I was saying, whatever stotra means the encomiums that you chant must uplift you. They should not bind you in the world of things. Next verse, let us make progress. Atapi mandali murtyuhu. Pingala sarvatapanaha కవిర్విశ్వో మహాతేజాః రక్తః సర్వభవోద్భవః. దిస్ ఫాలోస్ ది స్టాండర్డ్ టైప్ ఆఫ్ విష్ణు సహస్రనామ. ఇట్ విల్ చేంజ్ లెటర్ బట్ ఇన్ ప్రథమా విభక్తి ఇన్ ది ఫస్ట్ కేస్ ది డిస్క్రిప్షన్ డిస్క్రిప్షన్ ఈజ్ కాల్డ్ నామ. సో ది డిస్క్రిప్షన్స్ సో ఆర్ ది అడ్జెక్టివ్స్ అట్రిబ్యూట్స్ ఆర్ ప్రెజెంటెడ్ ఇన్ ప్రథమా విభక్తి. సో ఆఫ్ ది సన్ గాడ్ ఇన్ పర్టికులర్ అండ్ ఆఫ్ బ్రహ్మన్ ఇన్ జనరల్. ఆతపి ది వన్ హూ ఇస్ ది సోర్స్ ఆఫ్ ద హాట్ సన్. ఆతప ఈజ్ ఆ సమంతాత్ తపతి. సో ది హాట్ సన్ హాట్ ది వెరీ బ్రిలియంట్ అండ్ హాట్ ది సన్ లైట్ అండ్ దట్ వాట్ ఈస్ ది సోర్స్ ఆఫ్ దిస్ బ్రిలియంట్ అండ్ హాట్ సన్ లైట్ ద సన్. సన్ ఈజ్ కాల్డ్ ఆతపి. ఆతప ఆతపి ధన becomes dhani. The one who has dhana is called dhani. The one who is the origin of atapa means very scorching sun, blazing sunlight. The origin of that sun, the sunlight is the sun. So in a place like Arizona, where the sun is very brilliant and very bright and very hot also, you don't need any idol and all that to worship God. Only you must be focused, that's all. So you step into the sun, the glory of God is all upon, is pouring upon you, and it you can remember easily God by stepping into the sun. Atapi, okay. Then so therefore you don't need any other arrangements. So just step into the sun and have that vision of upasana in you. Already you are in the temple of God, contemplating upon the God. Atapi. Then mandali. You see, tapa alochana, that is also another meaning. Tapa alochana means the power of thinking in you that comes from the sun of atma from within. And the power of thought alone enters into the eyesight, becomes the cognition of the forms, enters into the ears, becomes the cognition of sounds, etc. Therefore, that light, that inner light, the brilliant inner light, light of awareness, which comes into the thought, and then through thought it comes into the five sense organs, giving all cognitions to you in life, that is the atapi, the inner sun of atma. Okay, then mandali, you look up, you see the sun as a big disk in the horizon. Mandala is the disk, solar disk or sun disk. It appears two-dimensional. Disk is two-dimensional, more or less, okay. Whereas sun is not two-dimensional. It is a globe, not a disk. But because of the distance, it appears like a disk. Okay, therefore the mandali means the one who appears like a mandala, a disk. But then he is not disk, he is a globe, the way he appears. So the word mandala is meaning is vartula, one which is round. That is mandala. So therefore the solar disk, that is the sun. And therefore that is the God. You don't need any other altar. That is the altar. The sun is rising, you are looking at the disk. Sun is setting, you are looking at the disk. The disk, the one who has the disk, who is shining as the disk, is the God, mandali. Only you should not look directly to the sun. Even the rising and setting sun also, you should not look directly. Some basic physics, if you have studied the first chapter of light, which is taught in high school, they put the sunlight as parallel rays. Sunlight is always parallel rays. Whereas the rays coming from a bulb, they are divergent rays. Whereas sunlight is parallel rays. And the parallel rays fall upon a lens, and they get focused to a point. And the eyesight, the iris is the lens, and the parallel rays, they get focused on the retina, which is the screen that captures the focused light. Okay? And therefore, retina will be affected by the focused light. And that is not good for the retina, because when all these parallel rays are focused, then the point of focus, that is called focal point, will have condensed energy at that point. Therefore, not good for retina. What happens is, there is a light black spot will form on the retina. And if this is repeated again and again, all this time looking at the sun, so slowly the retina will lose its ability to see the forms. Therefore, you should not directly look at the sun, even while rising and setting. What to speak of the other time? You have to look at the sun, you look at the disk, you have seen the disk, just look and then divert the attention, divert the eyesight, look at the light which is around. One time you look at the disk and immediately take the face away from the sun, don't look directly. That precaution is important. Some of these people who do not understand the science, etc., you know what they do? They look at that sun and start saying the mantras. Because sun is very mild, he is not very hot and not very bright also while rising and setting. Therefore, directly look at the sun and chant the mantra. And if the mantra takes, say, 5 to 10 minutes, you are looking at the sun directly 5 to 10 minutes. Means you allow the parallel rays to fall upon the eye lens directly for a longer time, which is not good. One should not do that mistake. So that is an advice. Then, you see, dialogue with death, I have mentioned it. God is not only life, God is death also, I mentioned. Sun is life and sun is death. You see, it is said in the Veda Mantras, you look at the sun yonder, he is rising. He is rising, taking away a piece of your life. And then in the evening, you look at the sun in the yonder, in the horizon, and do namaskar. It is all right, he is setting. You think sun is setting, sun is rising. But it is not simple sunrise and sunset. He is pulling out another piece of your longevity. A few times sun rises and sets, you will fall dead. So sun is the death. It is said like, a person's life is like a deck of cards. So sun rises, take out one card. Next morning sun rises, take out another card. And finally, the last card is taken out. Sun will be rising only, but the person will fall dead. Therefore, sun is death, mrityuhu. Of course, sun is life also through photosynthesis. So what is life? Is also death. Vayuhu, is it life or death? So when you inhale, it is life. When you exhale, it is death. It is both. Longevity, yeah. Sun, what he cooks the body. Sun cooks the body. Pachati. So like you cook rice in the kitchen, sun cooks all of us. And as we get cooked, we fall dead after some time. That's why sun is the mrityuhu. Four deaths were described. The sun, the moon, the fire. Because moon also rises and sets. Death is. Because people count days based on the movement of moon. Padyami, Prathama, Dvitiya, etc. And people count days based on the movement of sun also. In both cases, this calendar is death, appa. Calendar is death. That's why when they celebrate December 31st, it is not a time to celebrate, it is time to sit and cry, because 1 year is gone. Your life is gone, 1 year is gone, gone waste or whatever, you have to see. How this 1 year went by, you have to pay attention to that and learn a lesson or two from that. and take a resolve to make the coming year better than what the year that went by. It is a time for contemplation. It is time to become a bit morose, because one more year of life is gone. Whatever life is left is reduced by one more number. So we are not going to live as long as we lived earlier. Then why are you celebrating? What is there to celebrate? This celebration is born out of ignorance. You should not go for celebration and all that. You should sit and meditate, not celebrate. People are ignorant, and therefore they cannot stay with themselves. Therefore they are always looking for an escape, because people are lonely within, and they are trying to escape from that loneliness and that unsatisfactoriness, and so they find some excuse to celebrate. So a child asks the mother, "Mother, when is my birthday?" Because friend's birthday happened, I got the chocolate, but when is my birthday? So because the child is anxious to get its birthday. That's why in New Jersey, they celebrate 6 months' birthday, not 12 months' birthday. Therefore, every child celebrates birthday twice in a year. So elders are no different. So they don't understand that it is not so much birthday. It is the day that indicates or that points out the time of death is ahead of you, closer to you. That is what it is. Therefore, the sun god is Mrityuhu. And so as you contemplate upon Mrityu, death, you become wiser and you get Vairagya, dispassion, and you are likely to get the jnanam also, atma jnanam also. Therefore, you see, what we do is, we keep life in the present, but we push the death to tomorrow. Not one tomorrow, 1,000 tomorrows or 1,000 tomorrows. After 1,000 tomorrows, I will die. No, that way you cannot separate life and death like that. Life is the sun, death is the sun, both are now. Life is vayu, death is vayu, both are now. So agnihi, fire. Fire is cooking food, not only cooking food, cooking us also, the inner fire. Therefore, fire is death, wind is death, sun is death, moon is death. 4 deaths are described in the Vedas. That's why they have a dialogue with death, friendship, befriend the death. That is how the upasana is understood. Then what happens? The fear of death will go away. People are afraid of death. Then pingalaha means having the color of honey colored. That is the sun in the rising time, sunrise, it looks like honey colored, red, ruddy. And the setting sun is also having the color of honey, pingalaha. So the rising sun and setting sun is always pointed out. Sarvatapanaha scorches everybody. Sun is the scorcher of everybody. Sarvatapanaha. So people who, especially in India, we live close to equatorial line. And therefore, the sun's rays fall directly without any angle. People around equatorial line experience the hotness, the heat of the sunlight. And so people, they are all made to suffer the heat. That is sarvatap, all life forms. You can see it. You must have seen it. In India, in summer, especially April, May in Hyderabad will be particularly bad. Must be something like July, August in here. But here in July, August, you don't step out. You sit in the air-conditioned car and go. In India, we step out. What car? We walk in that sun. And if it is a black-topped road walking, The chappal gets stuck to the tar, melted tar. Tar melts. And you are walking on the tar, a blacktopped road, and that has melted, and the chappal won't come up. Okay, if the chappal doesn't come up, you put your foot on the road, it will be burnt. So that is the kind of heat. When you are going in the car, the wheels make wheels. The car slows down, and the wheels make some sound of going through molten tar. That is the kind of heat in April, May. And then people are going. People, elderly people also go. When I go in that situation, I take an umbrella and go because I don't want to get sunstroke. There is a thing called sunstroke. Elderly people get it. Young people don't care. They are very energetic. Therefore, they can manage that. But elderly people get sunstroke. So we get sunstroke in April, May. You know how we face sunstroke? However much water you drink, you will be still feeling thirsty. That is the indication that summer has come. And then what we do? We get electrolytes and dissolve in water and drink that electrolyte water. That rehydration we do. And then the thirst will be in some control. Otherwise, a whole day you are with thirst. And you will be drinking water, thirst. Some more stomach becomes like this, but thirst doesn't go away. So April, May, it is not easy to live in that climate. And it is not central air conditioned. One room is air conditioned. And you enter into the room and sit in the air conditioner for a while and then come out. And sun gives a slap in the face. When you come out of the air conditioning, it is like you are slapped in the face, hitting in the face. We don't step out. Morning 9:30, after that we don't step out. We remain in shade, and the evening after 5, again we step out, not before, the in between. Sometimes you need to step out in between, then you see dogs moving here and there helplessly, and a bull, a cow, a buffalo, they'll be standing there, scorched, being scorched by the sun. You can see in their face the suffering. All human beings who are traveling on the road, elderly people, working people, they're all facing the heat. You can see in their faces the effect of the hot sun. They're all suffering. You can see the suffering in their faces. You can see the suffering in the dog, in the bull, in the buffalo, in the cow, in all human beings you can see. And if some water is, you throw some water, immediately birds will come and drink that water. A dog will come and with its tongue, a tongue will be protruding and hanging. With that hanging tongue, it will suck up that water. And monkeys, there are a few monkeys, they come and suck up that water. All animals, birds, etc., every life form is going through the intense suffering caused by the sun. Sarvatapanaha. Then we say, oh Bhagavan, you are making us go through this. So we make a prayer and keep quiet. In the meanwhile, monsoon comes. So ghanavrushti rapam mitraha appears. We see the extremes of this weather, and in both cases we practice endurance and we pray to sun god in both instances. Sarvata apanaha. Then kavihi, he is all-knowing. Where is all-knowing sun in you? Because you are all-knowing. This kavihi sarvajnaha. So what the dualists do, you know, this is a trap in which they find themselves and they try to push us into that trap. Kavihi is all-knowing. All-knowing is God. And where is God? In Vaikuntha. He is in Vaikuntha and all-knowing. How can he be all-knowing while sitting in Vaikuntha? What is in his eyesight, he can know. Something is happening in on earth, how can he know? No, he is God, he is all-knowing. So, whereas about, what about you? You are alpajnaha, you know very little. Whereas God is all-knowing. The truth is, you are that all-knowing God. Why? You look at this word all. All is a universal set. All is universal set. In set theory, there is a thing called universal set. All the people in the hall, that is a universal set. That is all. And what is that all? 30. Okay? All the people in Phoenix, that is another universal set. And how many, what is that all? 100,000. So, like that, this all is relative. Now I ask you, when you wake up and when you are doing things, you are living the day, do you know all or not? You know all. You know all. Right? Only Vishnu knows all. What about you? You know all. You are driving. You know all or not? You are in the home, dealing, cooking food. You know all or not? Without knowing all, how do you cook food? That is the all, okay? Therefore, God is all-knowing, and you are that God, Kavihi. Where are we? We started at 6:30, right? Good. Sometimes I lose track of the time. Then Vishvaha. God is not only all-knowing, but God is also all-being. Because there is no separation between being and doing. What about you? Are you, do you exist or not? Yes, I exist. Do you know or not? Yes, I know. So this I am is both existence and knowledge. It is both. I am is both existence and knowledge. I am is existence and I am is knowledge. And there is no distance between the two. Both are I am. Same is the God. God is all being and also He is all knowing. As all knowing Kavihi, as all being Vishvaha. Vishnu Sahasranama also begins with Vishvam. Pumsakalinga, doesn't matter. Vishvam or Vishvaha. Therefore, God is all being. That is Vishvaha. So, you see how Vishvaha, God is in the form of earth, in the form of waters, in the form of wind, in the form of heat, and in the form of space. That is all. Nothing is left now. Even when you look at yourself, you are those five elements only as physical body, and also as antahkarana, also you are five elements only, subtle elements. And therefore, God is all being, because God is Prithivi, God is Apaha, God is Agni, God is Vayuhu, God is space. So what does it mean, you know? It means you are walking on God, you are drinking God when you drink water, you are inhaling God when you inhale and exhale, and the heat in you is God, the one who digests food is God, and you are moving around in the space, that is God. You compare yourself with a fish in the ocean. The fish in the ocean, it is surrounded by the ocean. For the fish, ocean is the God. For you and me, the space is the God. Okay? That is Vishvaha. Now you know what is Vishvaha. Therefore, also in our religion, we say Prithivi Mata, Putroham Prithivyaha. In Telugu they say Nela Talli, the earth, Mother Earth, Mother Earth, Mother Earth. So how earth is mother? So that means God is in the form of earth. That idea translates as Mother Earth. Then take bath in waters, it is sacred. Why? Because God is in the form of waters. And that's why the sacred waters and sacred bath. That idea has its origin in God manifesting as waters. And God is Vayu, Vayu Devata. God is fire, Agni Devata. So we offer oblations in the fire because God is in the form of fire before us. And only Akasha people are not accustomed. I used to point out, You see, Lord Venkateshwara married the daughter of Akasha Raju. That is the story. That means what? Akasha, the daughter of Akasha is the sunlight or whatever, and Vishnu is connected with that. Like that you have to take. You should not take, because there is a dowry also. That means the story has become popular during those days when the kanyashulkam was popular. The dowry is of two kinds. Vara shulka, kanya shulka. So the man gives dowry to the girl to marry her. That is called kanya shulka. Shulka is the tax. So you pay dowry to the girl. That is kanya shulka. And you pay dowry to the boy. That is vara shulka. And so Venkateshwara Swami took a loan and paid money to the king Akasha Raju to marry his daughter. Means that story must have come during the days of Kanyashulka. Do you know the word Kanyashulkam? Gurujad Apparao's book Kanyashulkam you must have heard. So that story must have come during the days of Kanyashulka. Suppose the story came later, then Akasha Raju should have given money to Venkateshwara Swami to get his daughter married to him. So these stories, we have to look for any symbolism in that. Otherwise they look silly. So what is the symbolism? Why the king is Akasha? Because God is Akasha. That is the way you have to validate that story. Puja Swamiji used to say to me, "Are these Puranic stories, you look into some symbolism and tell people, that is the job of the Vedantins. They have to make those stories meaningful. Otherwise they are silly stories." He used to say like that. So now I found a way to connect the Akasha of the Akasha Raju to God. Got it? Some connection, you know. So God is Vishwaha. So, I lose track of time, it's okay. So Kavir Vishvaha, up to that we have come. Mahatejaha Raktaha Sarvabhavodbhavaha. That we will finish tomorrow. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate.